Hello and welcome to the podcast that explores the inner workings of the Heartland Entertainment Industries. I'm Brian.
I'm Kelly.
And we're back. It's been a while.
Yeah.
We've had some time off, but now we're back.
Yeah.
And the crazy thing is, I think the last time we saw Miss Kelly over here, you didn't have what's going on down Hizzy.
I exploded.
It's number three. She sounded number three.
Number three. I don't know why. It's just we were, you know, didn't talk about it as much this time around. Like, I feel like I've waited so long and now all of a sudden I'm like halfway. I'm going to be that person
who just
a baby and put it on Facebook and people will be like, what? I'm like, yeah.
Now, here's the real question. Is this the last one?
I don't know. And that is a heated discussion between my husband and I because
you can't have a discussion, I guess, while you're pregnant.
Well, that's the problem is that he thinks it's too soon for me to even be talking about
it. Yeah, that's true. I mean, what's he going to do? Let's load up another
one. That's what I do is literally like I you know, probably like 6 months through pregnancy, I'm like, yeah, we'll have more kids. Yeah, we'll have. And then I get super miserable and I'm ready to have the baby. And I'm like, yeah, no,
just
done
get
it. And then like a week later, or maybe like in the hospital, even I'm pretty sure the last time in the hospital, I was like, I could do this again.
Right.
And then I go through sleep deprivation.
While they're cutting the umbilical cord. Yes. You're like, you know what?
I feel so bad. I could do this again. And then like, I'm totally, you know, up every 2 hours doing all the stuff with the newborn. And I'm like, I think I'm going to die. So it's a hard, when do we decide? I don't know.
The circle of life, the circle of infancy.
Yeah.
I'm always slightly jealous of women whenever they get pregnant because, like, if you're a smoker, it's like God's way of saying,
Got quit.
You right off.
You're done.
I'm going to cut you off by introducing a new human life into your body.
Well, and society is really good about guilting you, too. That's the better part is, like, even if you internally, deep down, didn't want to quit, like, you're like, no, I can justify this in my head.
Yeah.
Society is going to guilt you. So there's that.
God forbid.
That's like the one thing that everyone's like, no, it's okay to shame people for that, I guess. Like, yeah. I'm like, okay.
You're hiding with your pregnant belly in a dark alleyway, and the only thing illuminating the alleyway is the smoke and the cherry. And then some passerby just happens to see you and be like,
no, if you think about all the
trash.
Yeah, all the TV shows like Breaking Bad, where Skyler has the cigarettes in the car.
I know.
And I think the baby's either in the car or something. And I mean, literally, you can hear reactions all echoing. Yeah.
I think that's why
she has a baby.
I bet you that's why people hated that character so much.
Because she smoked while she was pregnant. She smoked while
in the womb.
Yeah. Yep. There you go.
I don't know if I've ever actually admitted this on the podcast, but I unfortunately I'm still a smoker.
I don't think
anybody really knows why they got started. It's just you look back and you're just like, this is something that's been a part of me. This is me. It's just like I'm walking around in a plume of smoke that no one wants to enjoy with me. I don't understand why when you go to the grocery store, why are there so many cigarette options? Like, especially in 2018, like you really only need three cigarette options. You need Kill Me Quickly, Kill Me Not Quite As Fast, and then like what's
like
the point?
Super skinny, like the little tiny
ones or whatever.
Yeah, like a little hint.
I got some Marlboro
taste.
Extremes the other day. It was just paper.
What's extreme?
No,
what's extreme? Marlboro Extreme.
No, but
extremeness.
Like, if you've ever ordered cigarettes at like a Walmart's, and then there's just a jubilee of cigarette options behind the counter, and so like, they keep changing the packs. So like, I can't just be dedicated to one brand. So I asked for my brand and they've changed the pack. So now I get to watch her like search through this giant array
it
of
all
cigarettes
comes back
like
down
a crappy
to the
Vanna
methods
White.
Of shaming. It's all little bits of shame.
Yeah.
Just trying to make you feel a little bad about it.
Because you're at Walmart. There's a line of people judging you.
Yeah.
And you're like, I prefer my cancer in this flavor. It's dumb. I've got a smoker's cough is not like a manly cough. Like, you never hear a smoker's cough and you're like, that is man.
Man
it's
cough.
It's just like,
man cough. Like,
yeah, like a man cough. You know, like you're coughing up, you know,
like I
have
a man
phlegm.
Cough in general just because I'm always sick.
I always have this like weak little.
The black
if you
lung,
listen
Brian,
back on this podcast,
it's the black
you
lung,
hear
Brian.
My smoker's cough going. It's pathetic. And I need to stop. Lainey quit. in January.
Good job.
And I need to quit as well. This is my way of shaming me.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm not going to shame you, but I feel like you should listen to this and then go through the shame yourself.
Yeah, because I have to edit. I have to edit this whole thing. So I get to listen to myself talk about the stupidity of what I'm doing. And like, and here's the thing, like cigarettes, it's not like any, like, I feel like any other drug out there, whenever you're doing said drug, you're like, party. No one's smoking a pack of cigarettes being like, party.
Party, party, like, party, drugs, man, drugs, drugs.
I really threw down, I killed like 3 packs of cigarettes the other day. And like, I don't even smoke inside anymore. I smoke in my garage. While I'm watching TV, we have a massive TV in the inside of the house, and I choose to be outside in the cold, freezing in the dark garage like a psychopath, like a crazy white trash golem.
Oh my gosh. You know, the just for fun facts, the version that which you speak of in the mom realm is scented candles now and air sprays. Like, that's like where you get mom shamed by like the people who don't. Like, there was, I think I actually read some like Newsweek article or study that was like, it's the same as smoking 20 cigarettes a day if you're smelling a candle.
What?
Yeah. Like, I don't know the sources. I'm not here to source the article. I'm just saying I did see it. And, so now I'm all worried about like these crunchy moms that I love all my crunchy mom friends that use their essential oils and stuff. I like the Bath and Body Works candles. They smell yums in my house. Right. And then my house doesn't smell like baby poop.
Yeah.
Which I could, yes, switch over to the oils, but those are expensive. So that's the new shame, is I feel like I have shame where I'm like, I'm sorry, I don't want to be causing you cancer with my
with
candle.
With your candle oils.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, so. I'm over in the corner.
Natural like, bees.
Is it pumpkin spice? Yeah. Is it cinnamon bits? No? We're dying together.
That's how we're going to go down, Brian. I'm going to be sniffing my candle. You're going to be sniffing your, smoking your cigarette.
What I don't understand, like, the fascination of, like, inhaling. I'm a smoker, and I still don't. I can't explain it to anybody. Like, why is this great?
Why is it good?
Like, pure air is not enough. I have to have this. And it doesn't smell good. It's just dumb.
You know. Well, now that we're all aware.
Today's episode is brought to you by shame.
Being aware of your stupidity.
Yeah. Being shame self-aware. Hey, so we have a really fun show today. We are talking to an awesome, not just an awesome person at what she does for a living, but also just an awesome person.
Oh,
you're pretty great. And I'm botching your intro because I put my notes back in my notebook here. I got this all prepared and everything. I was like, man, I'm going to introduce her like it's a real talk show. So just picture with your mind's eye that there's like a nice desk and she hasn't walked on stage yet. The band hasn't
been
played her own.
Sitting here listening to us just be ridiculous and stupid.
Right. So, ladies and gentlemen, her indie film, The Comedy Skid, was Dead Center Film Festival's Best Oklahoma Feature Film winner of 2015. And also won Best Oklahoma Feature at Red Dirt and Trail Dance, which doesn't exist anymore, which is sad. Boo. She is a creative consultant on Boo, which I love that is the title.
Well, I was to say, how should we say that? It should be like on Boo.
Yeah. Boo.
Boo. It's, I like that
Which
one,
is a script based on her beloved novel series. I looked at your novel series and it's pretty great. And it's actually, that is in development at Sony Malevin Entertainment with Andrea Nassfeld. Did I say that right? With Mom's Night Out. Her novel, My Life as a Doormat, was adapted into a Hallmark film called Love's Complicated,
woo-hoo,
which premiered in January on 2016 and scored 2.1 million viewers. She's the head writer for The Skit Guys, and her greatest accolade to date, she was the head writer for our 48-hour film that also won Best Screenplay.
Yes, very good. Yes.
Everybody, this is Renee Gutteridge, and she is awesome.
Aww.
Now you get to picture that there's like an audience here
cheering,
applauding crazily, throwing roses and underwear. Where did that come from? We don't know. One crazy fan.
Someone's excited.
So, thank you. That was, I'm not going to lie, I totally just, I pulled that. Because I was looking at your website and everything. I was like, how am I going to bring her on? Oh, she has a bio written right there. She's done the work for me.
You're welcome.
She's so great
favorite
at writing
guest
that she wrote herself on.
It's just to control how I'm introduced.
Right, yeah.
Sometimes it can get a little crazy. So I'm a control freak. Stick to the script.
Perfect.
Stick to the script.
Well, and it's great because like I knew that you were a screenwriter and that you've worked on different feature films. And like we've worked together with Skit Guys plenty of times. but I had no idea that you have a laundry list of novellas and novels and like all these crazy books. You're all over Amazon. So you're kind of a big deal.
But yet you didn't know. So
see, that's the beauty of being an author, though.
Is it Brian Oblivious?
Or? Yeah. I'm not sure.
At 9 times out of 10, that's usually what's really going on. So we're going to be talking to Renee today about screenwriting for the small screen or for the big gigantic screen. We're going to talk a little bit about feature films and like actually fleshing out a feature and like not only writing, but how to get started as an actual writer out there, like making a living writing. This is like one of those weird best kept secrets, I feel like, especially in the Oklahoma film industry. There's a lot of writers, but nobody really knows what to do to like get their stuff out there and to become like a writer. You'll throw that on a resume and stuff. So so my first question for you is, where do you get the gall?
I feel like that's a little abrasive, Brian.
Where do you get off? I actually had that written in there. I don't know why.
Where do you get the gall? To do the amazing things that you do.
That's why Kelly's ending. Here.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Well, it's just pure stupidity of not really understanding the odds that are against you when you start. And, you know, I just, I don't know. It's better not to know.
How did you get started in this anyway?
Well, I started when I was about 15. I began to understand there was a script to a movie. Like, I didn't quite, you know, it was back when you rented from Blockbuster a VCR tape.
I'm sorry, Blockbuster?
No. I know. So it was, there just, you know, there weren't bonus features. There weren't, you just didn't get the behind the scenes as much as you do now. And so I can't remember how I discovered there were scripts, but I went to the library and started checking them out. They had movie scripts.
Oh, yeah.
And then at the back of, maybe it was Time Magazine or something, they used to have ads that you could order screenplays for $3 and they would send it to you in the mail of like The Godfather or whatever film you wanted.
That's so cool.
And so I just started ordering these. I just started reading. And I thought, I want to do this. You know, I really want to do this. And my parents were completely freaked out. My mom is like a mathematician and a computer programmer, and my dad's a petroleum engineer. So they did not know what to do with me.
Artsy.
They were trying to be supportive, but also, you know, like trying to guide me into something more substantial, I guess. And so, and safe. But I just did it all the time. They bought me an Apple computer and I just wrote and wrote and wrote. And so then I went to college at OCU and they did not have a film program there. But they were really cool in that they let you create your own study. There was a professor there who had taught screenwriting. And so I took like beginning screenwriting, advanced screenwriting one, advanced screenwriting two, professional screenwriting. Like we just kept making up names every semester. And I just practiced. And
that's so cool.
Yeah. So, and then I got out of college and got married and stayed here. And that, I mean, there was no film scene here really in the 1990s.
When was this? Like,
the 95.
Wow.
Yeah. And so that dream sort of didn't die, but I thought I can't do anything right now. I had, do you remember Fine Line? It was an offshoot of New Line.
It was vaguely
kind of their indie sort of branch.
Yeah.
And they actually had a script of mine that Ed Harris was supposedly looking at.
Ooh.
And I was about 24 years old. And this is no lie, the producer had a nervous breakdown and completely left Hollywood.
He had a real nervous breakdown
and left. And at least that's the story that was told
in Hollywood.
Us.
What? You're kidding.
So that died. And after that, I couldn't get any traction or anything. So I just thought, well, I guess I'll write novels. And didn't know how to do that either. So
that's crazy. You actually started off as a screenwriter and then you moved to writing novels.
Yes.
Wow.
That's cool. I feel like, is it, Is it just me, or is it typically the reverse?
I think it's probably the reverse, because a novel is a little bit easier form of writing. I think it's not as technical. Mm-hmm. There's not software needed, you know, and people like to just sit down and tell a story, and people read novels more than they read screenplays. So screenwriting takes a lot more study.
Right.
But for me, I had to really reverse how I came to the page. And so the first time I attempted a novel, I just did everything wrong. I mean, I described the wallpaper on the wall. I described the wall. I described everything. And my professor at the time
sounds
was still
like a Tolkien book.
Yes, exactly. Well, and I had read Tolkien, and I had read C.S. Lewis, and all of those. So
very
I was
descriptive.
Just kind of, yes, and then of course you're made to read the classics. So
Steinbeck.
I thought I was completely.
I'm not gonna lie.
That or Judy Blume.
Yeah. I think in the Fellowship of the Ring, I got as far. I didn't even leave the Shire.
Oh, yeah.
Because Tolkien was still busy describing the Shire.
I pushed through to Two Towers, and I was about halfway through Two Towers. I was like, man, I don't know if I'm going to make it.
Like, he's telling us what Gollum looks like for five chapters.
The wart that grew four gnarly hairs directly out of it.
And then I love the fact that, we're going a little tangent, but I love the fact that, like, the Ents take so long to talk and get anything done. It's like, where do you think you got that idea there, J.R.R.? Think you got some inspiration from the mirror? Anyway.
Well, yes, it didn't help a young writer trying to learn how to write, let's say that, because it wasn't modern. So,
but that's good that you point out that, like, it wasn't a masterpiece on your first one.
Oh, no. It was terrible. And terrible. Yeah. In fact, my first published novel, I would also say, is pretty terrible.
And, is that the one that we should later on go to the Amazon reviews?
No. Please, no. It's actually unbelievably. It was published in 99, and it's still in print. And I still have people tell me how much they love it.
That's so cool.
That's cool.
Before Amazon. That's before self-publication.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I'm just glad, you know, I'm glad people read it, but I don't know. For me, I've improved so much over 2 decades of writing that when I look back at that, I'm like, I have made every error there was to make in fiction writing. But
that's such a good point for, like, anybody that's wanting to get into writing. Like, how many stories would you say that you've written ratio to how many have actually been published?
Oh, yeah. So, well, I probably wrote up to the point that I got published, I probably wrote 6 or 7 screenplays and at least 4 or 5 novels. And
my
in
gosh.
Fact, okay, you want to hear a fun story?
Yes.
Okay. I was working on a book called Troubled Waters. I hadn't been published or anything yet. I was working for First United Methodist Church downtown. And I was on my way to work when the Oklahoma City bombing happened.
Oh, wow.
And our church was right next door to the Murrah building.
Oh, man.
And so I just barely escaped, you know, being right in front of that building, because I would drive right in front of that building to get to my church. So anyway, that was quite an experience as a young person. But my novel that I was working on was inside the church.
Oh my gosh.
And it was on a floppy disk.
Oh.
If I need to explain that, let me know.
No,
yeah.
But
I still remember floppy disks. Yeah.
Floppy disk. And so the FBI took over our church and was also used as a morgue. And by the time we were able to get our stuff, that floppy disk disappeared.
They thought it was evidence. They were like, we should probably collect this. It's probably,
So somewhere.
Somewhere there is a copy.
FBI evidence, your novel.
Well, I always joke an FBI agent
lockdown.
Published it under a different
name. Someone was like, hey, it's pretty good. I did
eventually get that book published, so I don't know. But I had to start from scratch. I mean, I only saved it on this floppy disk.
There's no cloud. There's nowhere to go.
There's no cloud. I just think of floppy
disk.
Is it sad that the first thing I think of is like the metal piece that you would just flip and like clip
mess
floppy
with it.
Discs. The 90s kids fidget spinner.
Yeah, basically. Like, ding,
ding. Sometimes there's a novel on it and it goes into FBI evidence. Will that ever happen to your fidget spinner?
Yeah.
No. So wow. what do you suggest to young writers with getting started with all this?
With writing or like trying to get published or sold?
I would say just with writing in general.
Yeah, I tell people it has to be a commitment of time. That's the biggest thing for people. I think people always feel inspired to write, but you have to commit the time. And it doesn't need, people think that it has to be a large swath of time. I have to have 5 hours, but you can actually get more done in an hour than you can if you have 5 hours, just because, you know, it's like I got 60 minutes and you just plug right in and you go, yeah, instead of thinking and your mind wandering and being distracted. So, and you also have to really get over self-editing and making sure, you know, that
perfection.
You're doing it right and perfection. You yeah. just, you have to go, you have to put yourself out there and you have to let others read your work. And it's very, very scary to
you
do that.
To, yeah. It's pretty vulnerable to like, be like, okay, this is it. Yeah. Read it.
Yeah.
You know,
and,
what's funny?
And it's asking, it's like reading, but asking for criticism, like specifically, yeah, like,
specifically,
yeah,
asking,
you know,
for criticism.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. My biggest problem whenever I was, well, I guess I still have this problem of like, I'll write, like whenever I'm working on a script, I'll write just a scene. Yeah. I won't even finish the scene. I'll have written like a couple things in there. They're like, oh, I like this. I like this. Lainey, read this. Mom, read this. Everyone read this. It's only a paragraph, but it's gold.
And that's okay. I mean, I love that. You know, I love that a lot of people just won't ever let anybody read it.
But then I'll never finish it.
I would say that's the thing too, I think about is finishing it, because I have a problem with like finishing projects. I'll start a crocheting. Like right now I literally have 3 sweaters that I have partially knitted, and I'm very proud of the partially knitted sweaters, but they will never get finished.
Lots
like, let's be honest. Yeah. Like, yeah. You don't get sleeves, Oliver. Yeah. It's just a hoodie sweater without sleeves.
A lot of potential leg warmers.
Yeah. Yeah. Just one.
Yeah.
I made one.
Yeah. There are one person's one leg is very warm.
It looks very nice. Yeah, so you have to like be willing to commit to finish as well. I mean, that's probably a.
I think at the time when you're ready to look at it professionally, yes. Before then, I wouldn't worry too much about it. You know, like young people, like their parents will come up to me and they'll say, well, he just keeps starting stories and so that's okay. You know, that's how I was. I mean, I would just start, I'd get 6 chapters in.
Makes me feel better.
And then I would start over. Yeah. I think that you don't want to ever take away the fun of it for the writer. And so if you start putting pressure on either yourself or a young person, then you kind of take away the magic of it. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, at the point that they decide or anybody decides they want to do it, that will kick in. That self-discipline, I think, kicks in. And they finally finish something.
Yeah, yeah.
Even if it's something small.
One thing that I really like to do with my buddy Patrick, who was the director of The Office Case, we like to just, I'll have coffee and he'll stare awkward at me because he doesn't drink coffee because he's a communist. Like we like to do we'll bounce log lines. So instead of like, I've got this, you know, instead of like working out a full script or something like that, like we'll just pitch log lines.
Oh, that sounds fun.
And like for the listener that doesn't know what a log line is.
Oh, a log line is an extremely difficult little summary of a movie.
Oh man.
And
I feel like I'd be so bad.
It's harder than it looks actually. And cause you have to put a lot of thought into it and you're supposed to compare, you know, one movie to another you're pitching it in front of
Die Hard meets Die Hard 2.
Yeah. It's, I don't like it, but I love hearing people do it. Because it kind of gets your creative juices flowing and that sort of thing. And so, but I have one, project in particular, that I've had the most difficult time just writing the log line.
Yeah.
I mean, I've written the treatment. I've written the whole first draft of the screenplay, but I can't get the log line down. Yeah. So I've always been really bad at that.
See, for me, I'm so ADD that like I have the hardest time. Like, I have to take my little CBD to be able to chill so that I can, like, actually work on a script. And in the meantime, I'm just, like, cranking out sentence-long movies.
Yeah, that's amazing.
That is. I know. Let's combine these into
with our forces combined.
Yeah. We'll make a movie.
But so, you know, once the aspiring screenwriter has gotten started, like now they're just writing scenes and stuff like that. Like, let's talk about now. You are the head writer for Skit Guys,
right?
And so we were kind of talking about this off the air, quote unquote. Let's just pretend like it's actual radio. But how, like, with Skit Guys, y'all do a lot of short films, but y'all also do a lot. Y'all do all sorts of different things.
We do. Yeah, that's awesome. Do a lot of. We're a fairly, I think, big company. I mean, it's a small studio, but we have a lot of different products that we put out, including short films, comedy pieces. Tommy Woodard and Eddie James are the Skit Guys, and they tour as comedians all over the country. And so we're always producing and writing, and not just me. We have a whole creative team that writes, and we read each other's work, and we critique. And I mean, it is very cool. It's a great environment, but it's not an easy environment. You know, you have to be willing to take somebody else's joke over years if it's funnier. Mm-hmm. And so as a professional writer over the years, I've learned to kind of let go of my own thing, making it my own, and kind of embrace collaboration, which is actually a lot more fun at the end of the day. Yeah.
Yeah. I feel like with what we're doing with some of our video sketches, that's where we're learning. We're in the process of learning that right now.
We're figuring it all out.
We're throwing some ideas out. We're taking some ideas, and we're trying to, like, just learn how to collaborate really well with, like, a group of people that are all motivated. And that's the other thing is, like, motivation to get it done and make things happen. So it's a process. Cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
We may have been stealing some ideas from the good old Skit Guys. Not, like, content wise, but just, like, y'all's method of how, like collaboration like that. Like, you know, cause what we've been doing lately with our little sketches is, like, we'll just invite everybody that wants to come out. And then everybody pitches a different log line and whichever are the ones that are not only the most funny ideas and attractive ideas, but also most producible ideas.
Right.
Those are the ones that stick. And then everybody kind of goes off into their corners and writes for a week. And then we come back together and we have our treatments written out, and we kind of give each other notes and everything. Then we go back to our corners.
Can you throw out what treatment is, just for people, like, not me maybe, but me. Tell me what it means, just so I am not in the dark.
So a treatment.
I guess it's a synopsis. I mean, it's a synopsis of what you plan to write.
Okay.
Yeah. And so they can range, in feature films, they can range from, like, 7 pages to 30 pages, depending on what the producer wants to see. In novels, we call it synopses.
Okay.
And it's the same thing. It's written in present tense. I mean, there's a little bit of a form to it, but it's a nice way to understand where you're going.
Well, and it's great because, like, whenever you're writing out these treatments, and for us, it's like our sketches are, like, maybe 8 pages long. And for listeners, we're going to talk about in a second, like, the formatting of why page numbers and all that kind of stuff is kind of important. But, like, it's nice whenever you're writing something that is very, very short, I guess for any length, but just, like, to actually see the structure of it, the beginning, middle, and end.
Right, the story structure and the,
Because, like, I come from public speaking background where we would outline our stuff.
Here's what,
like,
I'm going to tell you. I'm telling you.
Yes.
This is what I told you.
Boom, exactly.
I remember.
She remembers.
Thank you, Mrs. Mason from 7th grade.
But, like, with the Skit Guys, whenever you guys are writing your films, like, go back and kind of describe the process there.
Well, we know what we kind of work backwards from the date it will be released. And then we have our producer, Amanda Hayden, which, you know, she'll work backwards and look at due dates. And then from there, we will set our writing deadlines. And so then I'm kind of overseeing, making sure that all the scripts are coming in when they should. It's a difficult process. Writing, you know, it doesn't always strike you when you want it to. So we try to give ourselves plenty of time. And then we, you know, each person who's writing goes and writes, and then we come back, and usually I'm feeding notes and people are feeding notes to me, and then we go back and write. I mean, basically exactly what you described. And then we come and we'll do basically a table reading, although it's over a conference call because we're all over the country.
Yeah, you guys are spread out.
We're spread out. And so, we'll do that.
I know, that sounds so cool. Hey, Brian, I think I'm going to move to Kansas and then we can conference call.
We can conference call.
It's not as fun as
it's still in the heartland.
Yeah. It's really hard to be on a 5-hour phone call and not see anybody's faces.
That's true. You know,
there's like more energy when you're in a room than over a phone. And we've actually talked about that, how it's difficult to do that, but we manage it. And then we, you know, get our scripts in final shape and off they go to the other side, the producing side.
How important do you think it is to have a deadline to set for yourself?
Well, I think it's super important. And it's also really important to teach yourself how to hit those, because once you move into professional writing, it's all about the deadline. And, you know, I tell my kids, you know, I'm not the most talented writer out there, but I've gotten a lot of work over the years because people know I can hit deadlines. And you can have the most talented writer out there, but he or she doesn't do you any good if they can't deliver.
George R.R. Martin.
Yeah.
Leaving me hanging with another. Oh, I'm going to start a different book and not finish the last two. I'm dying. Sorry.
Song
that
of ice and right fire, there. Indeed.
If you weren't such a genius.
The ice has melted and then it froze over again because it became summer and then winter. The years are progressing,
he's
George
R.R. He's going
to
die before he finishes it.
There's a part of me that wonders.
I'm upset. Long-term bet, Brian. Long-term bet. Right now, he dies before he finishes the seventh book.
I think that would be very appropriate for Game of Thrones.
I think so, too.
Everyone is killed off, including the author
including
himself.
Including the author, and the audience is still left going, why?
Yeah. Everyone dies, so like the story just becomes meta at that point.
Sorry to tangent off that, but I've been thinking about it for a while, George R.R. Martin. I know you're listening.
Oh, goodness.
If you're listening, stop it and go write.
Stop it.
Yeah.
Real quick, what are some good sources for screenwriting software?
Because I feel like I am so, look, Brian does a lot of the writing. I like to talk about ideas and not do any of the actual work involved.
Dude, here's the thing though. For me, like I can come up with kind of like, there's a hero and he has a problem. And he solves the problem. We don't know how he solves it. There's no middle. I'm great at coming up with beginnings and ends. But if I could just, it's like the lead like steps out into the theater, the lights go dark, and then the lights come back up, and he's vanquished the dragon.
There you go, yeah. And I'll be like, what if he had ostrich wings? I don't know why, but developed the story from there. No, but like, I think that would be something that I would be nervous about just formatting. I have no clue. I would love to maybe start writing, but that's something that has held me off from it just in my own head of like, I don't even know where to, so you have software. What's a basic software that someone like off the street could try to like look at?
Okay, the basic, there's several free ones, but the one that I've heard is the best is Celtics.
Yes.
Okay.
And it I think it has a few quirks in it, but for the most part, it will format good enough.
Okay.
And then I'm a big Final Draft fan. I've used it since college, and it's amazing. It's just, it makes, you don't even have to think. Starts predicting your characters for you. It's like, I know who's going to talk next. I mean, it's really slick. So it just allows you to just write and not, I mean, I'm totally aging myself right now, but when I first started screenwriting, we used WordPerfect.
Oh, I remember WordPerfect.
Yes. And we had to create macros to create our own margins.
Oh, wow.
I literally didn't understand most of what you just said.
That's not a joke.
I know. It was terrible. It was really, really terrible.
It sounds so complicated.
It was super complicated. And so when Final Draft was eventually available outside studios and stuff and affordable for people, I bought it right up and I've used it ever since.
Yeah. So, yeah. And how important is it for the listeners, like how important is it to understand formatting for the script, for screenplays?
It's really, really important. There's a great book that I love called The Hollywood Standard. And now there's a second one out, The Hollywood Standard 2. You need more than just software. The software can format it, but you also need to understand the technical side of writing it. So screenwriting is half a technical document and half a creative document. And so the creative is the story, but the technical is for the production side of it. So you have to understand why certain things have to be in there the way that they are. And, you know, once you move into trying to get things produced, if it doesn't look professional and like you have no idea what you're doing, then that's really going to hold you back.
Yeah. And I could speak from the producing side of things. Like whenever somebody is presented a script, people on the production side of things are extremely lazy. So the less we have to think, the better. Think of it as like you're just handing over the simplest document possible so that they don't have to think about
anything.
This
maps it out for you.
Yeah.
Well, and to give you an example, a real life example on set, this last time we were all together with the skit guys, somehow something got dropped out of an action sequence. And the only mention of the prop was in the parenthetical. Well, the producing side, the producers or whoever's getting the props, they don't ever look at the parentheticals. They're not actually reading the script.
Right.
The bottom line.
They're hitting
their
points.
Looking at page numbers.
Yeah. That's right. They're looking at page numbers and they're going through and counting props and looking at lighting and things. So, we show up on set and nobody has
not
the
there.
Glitter
because
it was only in the parenthetical. And so, you know, it is. And that just accidentally got dropped. But, you know, it's important and people. And the amazing thing about like the correct formatting is that it really is truly one page per 1 minute of film.
Yeah.
It works out like that. It's amazing. So
it really is uncanny.
It is. It's amazing to watch.
And it's really cool. Like whenever you're breaking down, like whenever it moves into production, for the listeners, I'm not talking to Renee right now. I'm talking to you. Renee, let me school you on how this all goes, okay?
Mansplain,
my mansplaining moment. No, like whenever you're breaking down a script in order to make the thing happen, like they're breaking it down by scenes and they're cutting it down to, they're looking at eighths of a page and all that kind of stuff. And that's how they structured the full on schedule and everything. So that, like if your formatting is off and that one page equaling 1 minute of edited screen time is not quite correct, mm-hmm. it's kind of got like that annoying balloon, like snowball effect.
So it kind of hold up the production of it because it's not hitting those right.
It's easy to cheat. Like if I'm working on a project and I know it has to be 90 minutes or less and I've hit 108 pages, it's very tempting to go back and start putting paragraphs together the dirty tricks of writing, but it comes back and bites you. So you just try to not implement those because they can really cause trouble on the other end.
Now, so we've talked about keeping it very, very like kind of simple and everything, but how do you feel about adding kind of like, camera notes and that kind of thing in the screenplay itself, like medium shot, wide shot, pan to the left, dolly right, mm-hmm. within the screenplay itself?
So I only use a camera direction if the camera direction is a reveal or a comedy point. I never ever tell the director what to do. That's one of the things that's really ingrained is everybody stays in their own lane. Right. But there are times when you need, something to be revealed in a certain way. So almost all of what I do is maybe tilt down, pan left, or a wide shot to show something suddenly. But otherwise, I leave that to the director. And I don't have any directing ambitions at all. I never, ever want to direct anything.
There's an example. We just had a directing episode. Oh, and I feel like we always talked, we talked about how a lot of people, maybe they think they kind of want to be a director. Yeah. Here's one. She doesn't.
You don't want to.
She doesn't want to.
I feel like no ambition. Yeah. It's so much attention to detail. And stressful. It doesn't appeal to me at all. So I don't ever struggle with trying to tell the director what to do. I don't want to be the director.
Bye. I feel like most film students want to be directors until they actually find out what being a director is, and they realize how crazy stressful it is, and then they're like, you know, I'll be a sound guy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, that's how I feel about stage management. When I was in theater, in college, I was like, oh, I think I have an eye for, I could do stage management. And then I took the class, and I was like, no, I am so impressed with people who do it well, and I know some people. I'm like, you. I worship you because no way. Yeah, that's too much work. Too much work. I'm a lazy person.
That's why
I'm slowly discovering my laziness as I age, in different ways. I'm like, I'm pretty lazy.
Taylor, you're about to be a mom of three.
I know.
You don't get to call yourself lazy.
That's how it works, though, is I'm not lazy there, and so I get to be lazy with everything else.
You're not being lazy. You're refining yourself.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
You're just dumping off the things that don't matter.
That don't matter at all to me.
You're just shaving off all the fat.
Don't be surprised, Brian. Baby number five is going to hit at some point. I'm going to be like, hey, Brian, listen, I know the podcast's going really well. I'm out, bro.
Can't you call in? Yeah. That's what's going to happen. You're going to have your small litter of kids.
Yeah.
And we're just going to have you on an iPad.
Yeah. And then
with your face.
Eventually I'll be able to reemerge into society when the oldest one, when Oliver can take care of the little ones.
Yeah.
That's
there you
my
go.
Goal.
That's my diabolical plan. That's our diabolical plan for me and Lainey having kids.
Yeah.
We're waiting for your kids to get to babysitting age.
They need responsibility. Yeah. You're going to go watch Brian's kids, mommy and Brian do a podcast.
We're going to eventually have a nursery. So, there's the hobbyists that are writers. And I feel like there's quite a few of those. And there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. I consider myself a hobbyist writer. But then there's the professional people. And we've kind of touched on how, being able to hit a deadline is really important. Really, really important. Staying in your lane is really, really important. But what are some ways to really get out there in the professional world of representation, management, that kind of thing?
In screenwriting?
Yeah.
I don't have a clue. I have to tell you, it's really interesting because in fiction writing and in publishing, there's a very straight and narrow way of how you get your book published. You find an agent, your agent pitches to all the major publishers, and you either get rejected or accepted. And it's like that every time. Now, Amazon has changed a little bit of that in adding self-publishing, but traditional publishing, where you're getting royalty and you're on the bookshelves and that sort of thing, that's how you go. I mean, you find an agent, you get your book pitched, and that's how every one of my books have been sold. In film, there just are no rules.
It's the Wild West.
And I've heard, all of my screenwriting friends have had different experiences of how they were discovered or how they continue to work. It's very slow. It's very methodical. You start, you make one contact on a film set or through a writing conference. And then 10 years later, that comes back somehow to employ you some other way. And so, my general rule has just been to try to walk through, the open doors that I can. And really, I got back into film from publishing. I desperately wanted to get back into film. And I was publishing. I was on, my 17th book or something like that. And I was really enjoying it. I loved it. But I knew my heart was in film still. And so I got this phone call, and it was this publishing house, and they said, hey, we heard that you have a film background, and we would like you to write a novelization. Are you interested?
Oh.
And I was like, yeah, I'm interested. Yeah, definitely. You know, let's set that up. And then I got off the phone, and I had to Google novelization.
What is
because this? I was not quite sure what that was.
Have you seen the movie adaptation of Nicolas Cage?
Yeah, I wasn't sure where that was going. But I walked through that door and I did it. The movie was called The Ultimate Gift. And I started getting these novelization jobs. Like nobody was really doing it. And so I just kept getting hired. And that opened some doors. I worked on a film called Old Fashioned, and the producer of that film read my novelization, and he hired me for a film project 4 years later. So it's just stuff like that, that, yeah. You know, I just try to take the opportunities that I can, big or small, and just do the best that I can. But it's like, you know, when you, like if you were saying you looked at my website, and if you look at that and you, it just looks so planned. And I was like, oh, she had this grand plan. Like, she she did this and she did that. And
oh, then, I thought you said bland. Oh. I was like, oh. It does not look bland.
Well,
that sounded really bad. It looks so planned. No, it doesn't.
It's chaotic and you need a new web design.
I looked at that website and I thought cluster.
Time for Brian's critique of web design.
Yeah, let me tell you how I feel about your website.
You should see my old one. I had my very first one for like 15 years. That's actually a pretty new one. But yeah, it's, you know, it's, it wasn't, it was just making a lot of mistakes, getting a lot of rejection, failing. You're only getting, it's like Facebook. You only get to see the happy moments on my website. Yeah. But if I had a list of all my, I should do that.
That's what we should do. Yeah.
I love that.
Just like, here's all the thing, accomplishments. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Rejection. Mm-hmm.
Like everyone can feel a little better about themselves that day. Like,
man. Yeah. Well, and that's the thing. Like, I feel like that's kind of been the recurring thing with a lot of these interviews. Like everybody that wants to do their dream job, I feel like people are too afraid of failure, you know, and then they then come to find out, like, everybody fails, dude.
Yep.
Everybody fails.
Steven Spielberg.
Fails, yeah.
Have you seen Doodlebug by Christopher Nolan?
No, dear I have not, Brian. Brian, what's the movie about?
Is it a log line? Okay, let me see if I can come up with a log line for Doodlebug.
Yes.
Christopher Nolan's Doodlebug. A man is trying to kill a bug in his apartment, and he can't kill said bug. But then he looks out the window, and he realizes that he is the bug. He's looking at himself through the window. What? It's so dumb. It's so bad.
That was my brain exploding.
Have I mentioned that movie on this show before?
Maybe. I don't remember.
I feel like
but
I have.
I like
have this vendetta against Doodlebug because Christopher Nolan's like one of my favorite filmmakers. He's one of the most amazing writers and directors and everything. And then I watch that piece of garbage.
Yeah, well.
And it should give you hope.
It does. Everyone
can be a Fergie every now and then. I'm going to go cultural pinpoint right there. Ooh,
topical.
Everyone has their bad moments.
Oh my God. How did that go?
The Fergie's song, I was thinking of National Anthem.
Yeah, that's what, like, it was like Marilyn Monroe. Yeah.
I don't know.
Anthem.
I just, I it was late at night when I watched it. I was just like,
oh, God, it was bad. Anyways.
Yeah, sorry.
Like tangent.
That's great. That gives me a nice break, and I'm just laughing, and it's fun.
I do feel bad, like, for all the things that Brian probably has to, remove because we tangent so much.
I'm leaving all this in.
It's all in.
It's all in. But the point is, failure. It's a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And the ratio of failures compared to success is like the iceberg. Beneath the water is all the failures, but it's what keeps the iceberg above the water.
And it's so beautiful. So beautiful.
Thank you.
That was so deep.
Thank you.
Yep.
I should write that.
You should. Submit that to skitguys.com.
Yeah.
Guys, Renee, step aside. The iceberg is an iceberg of failure.
That's a motivational poster.
Yeah, just remember.
An iceberg is an iceberg of failure.
So, how do you go about writing? And so we kind of touched on short form. Yeah, a little bit. Just screenwriting in general.
I'm a great, great host.
Killing it today. Back to failure. Failing at hosting. So let's talk about writing a feature film, which is typically how many pages or more, first of all?
Usually 90 to 120 pages.
That's more than I thought it was. I thought it was 60
pages or more.
Hour
and a half to 2 hours.
Makes sense.
Well, probably a feature is
like a kid's
by
film
61
usually,
pages, yeah. You might be in feature length. I am not sure about that. I think in terms of
like 60 like pages, like TV movie.
Yeah.
It's about all
true.
My son can handle on a kid's film. So if you go over that, we ain't watching the rest of the movie.
But 90 pages or more. How the crap do you write something that is cohesive at 90 pages or more?
Well, there's two types of writers. There's the planner or the plotter or the organized person. That's my friend, Cheryl McKay. She, her method is crazy. Like, she has sticky notes, different sticky note colors for the different plot lines and the different characters. And she has a whole binder of just stuff like this for each feature that she writes. So I'm on the very other end of the scale of that. I'm writing
on
napkins.
So she's your Leslie Knope.
And yes. Exactly. And I am
and
a
you're
mess.
Ann Perkins.
Yeah.
I can't find the note that I wrote this little thing on, and I'm just scribbling everywhere. And really, I've learned now to keep all my notes at the bottom of the script I'm working on. But I literally start at page one. And I just start. And then I type the end.
Make it sound so simple.
It really produces very messy first drafts. You know, Cheryl, her first drafts are pretty nice because she has been understanding all the character arcs that are going on. And I have changed names of characters halfway through, not even known it.
Right.
He starts as Chuck, he ends as Bob.
Right.
I don't even know.
So the only one that can decode this cipher is you.
Right. It would be Christopher Nolan's first film if you didn't know what was going on. So that just works for me. I write by the seat of my pants. I write by my gut. I feel my way through. I've never been good at any of those kinds of programs where you start looking at, you know, your inciting incident and you need, now you have to abide by those in film because every producer is looking at that. But when I start, I just write. I think the inciting incident comes naturally. I think the first, second, third acts, those all come naturally for a seat of the pants writer. And then we go back and we organize it to where it's a little more cohesive. But that's just how I like to write it. I find beauty in that. I find fun in that.
I think that's cool, though.
Yeah, I like it like that. To sit there and, like, John Grisham, he plots his books for 3 months.
Oh, wow.
Outlines them and writes them in like 2 weeks.
Wow.
Man.
So it's all the prep and the organization coming out first rather than just like free flow. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. And that works for him, clearly.
Mm-hmm.
He's
doing
fine.
Yeah. No one's bashing John Grisham.
I'm not bashing him at all, but I'm just a little more of a free spirit on the page. And I, you know, I've been known, like, when I publish books, I have to send in a synopsis. They look at that and then they purchase the book. And then I write it. So that's how that works. And so
that sounds so stressful to me. Like, when I think about, like, okay, this is the idea I have.
Yeah.
Do you like the idea? Yes, we do. Now write the book. Oh, that just seems like a whole new.
Like, call me on that.
I like the idea too. Now is the rest of it good?
Well, it's very motivating when you've already cashed the check.
Right.
Oh,
yeah.
Man, yeah. That would be terrifying for me.
It's terrifying.
We like your synopsis, this paragraph that you've structured. Now here, take several thousands of dollars we're going to entrust to you. Give us a final product that will be gold.
Make it work.
So that these thousands of dollars can be many more thousands of dollars. Go, be fruitful. Now, that doesn't sound intimidating at all.
Oh, yeah.
Well, and then, you know, I know that's not what I'm going to write. I just almost write the synopsis I think will best get the book in the door.
Yeah.
And then I play. Mm-hmm. And so I will kill a character off mid-book, but the editor has no idea. And so I've had a couple of times when the editor's called me in the middle of reading the manuscript I've just turned in. And they're like, what? And I'm like, do you like it? And they're like, I love it. This is a perfect place.
That's
I'm like,
so cool.
Of course, because I felt it through my gut. You know, I'm like, I have to up the stakes here. Yeah. When I'm getting bored writing, that's usually when I kill somebody off. I should mention that
for,
I write
for
suspense.
Beginners. Okay.
Right. It sounds really
it's all romance.
Awful. Yeah, it's all romance novels.
But yeah, I write a lot of suspense. And so anyway, but that's my method and it doesn't work for everybody. And so
well,
I just
love that,
to
though,
find your
because,
way.
Like I, for me, what I hear whenever you say that is that there's not one perfect way to do this.
There's
multiple ways.
Yes.
Like find your rhythm, you know, find what works for you. Because mm-hmm. like, was it C.S. Lewis or was it J.R.R. Tolkien that would write? I think it was C.S. Lewis that wrote like half of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe and then just stopped and just started all over again and just like kept going. I think it was C.S. Lewis.
I don't know.
I don't know either.
I'm going to fact check you on that, Ryan. Everyone.
You're my Rachel Maddow.
Well, get on your phones.
There's a great, I don't know if you've read On Writing by Stephen King. It's my favorite.
The funny thing was, I was a huge Frank Peretti fan as a kid growing up. And then whenever I became an adult, suddenly I started reading Stephen King. And, uh-huh. and I feel like everybody I talk to, that's the opposite.
It's opposite.
Oh, I always start with Stephen King and then they go Frank Peretti.
Uh-huh, uh-huh. My mom was a Stephen King fan. And so as a little kid, I remember her reading these books. And so I started reading Stephen King probably when I was 15 or 16.
That's the suspense that you like uh-huh. so much. Yeah.
I never went quite into horror, but I just remember loving like Pet Sematary and all those.
Oh,
and
yeah.
So when I read his book On Writing, it just blew my mind because it just, first of all, validated a lot of things that I feel. And also Bird by Bird is a great writing book, too. But, you know, when you just read books by great writers and you understand that they have all of the insecurities that you do, all the trouble
that's
that
so
you
true.
Do, it's yeah. just like, it just frees you to just be like, okay, I'm not a freak. Because I think it's very easy to feel like a freak as a writer. You're in your head a lot. You're an observer typically more than a participator. And, you know, that's how I am. I mean, I go to a party if I go to a party. let's just pretend I went to a party.
Renee's a party animal.
Built up the courage to go to this party
out
now.
After 8 much, unless I'm running to Taco Bueno. But I like to sit and watch. You know, that's where I get my material is watching, especially a lot of my comedy material. And so, you know, it's just validating to understand that the process of being a writer is a cool thing. And part of that cool thing is learning to get tough and make your way through rejection. And I've had a lot of rejection. I mean, I've had books rejected. As we were talking earlier before the show started, the Amazon reviews are brutal. I mean, sometimes it's like, I really hated these characters. And sometimes it's like, I really hate her. I don't like her hair.
You as a person
then you just
made
like,
me angry.
Mm-hmm, you made me angry. Yeah. Her name makes me angry. Yeah. Why does she spell her name like that? And so you just learn to get tougher and tougher and tougher. But, you know, I'm also, this is a very embarrassing story, but I'm going to tell it right here, right now.
Perfect.
Okay, show
breaking on. News.
Breaking news, real life here. But it's, you know, you work 20 years to become a professional writer. And also as a woman in the industry, it also can be intimidating and it can be difficult. And so you try your best to be.
I see no evidence to support that.
Well, I've been very lucky to work with great people, honestly, but you know, they're especially being young and being female, there was a lot that I had to work my way through in that. And, mm-hmm. But even just recently, I got a bit of a rejection moment, at a table full of, colleagues. and I burst into tears. I'm not proud of it. It was awful, and it made everybody feel awkward. It's
Renee,
not what you're striving for.
You can go to the bathroom.
No, I'm going to stay here and cry.
It was right when all the food was delivered to you. It was just...
Everyone just stop and eat while I cry.
It would have made a great movie moment. But for me, it was horrifying. But... I'm okay with that at the end of the day, because, you know, you can't have this hard heart when you're writing. I mean, part of what makes the artist is that we find beauty and we have sensitivities. And so once I lose that, then I think I've lost the magic behind it all. So, you know, I've had those moments. I try not to. That's actually only happened one time. I've never burst into tears anywhere. And I mean, I've sat across from editors where I've pitched my book and they've rejected me like flat out. Yeah. I had one guy try to just destroy me right in front of me. He just tried to destroy me. And I walked out with my head held high and I went around the corner and then
I
cried.
Yeah.
But you know, I am who I am. And so rejection doesn't get any easier. It just gets, easier to keep picking yourself back up. Cause you know, around the corner, there's going to be some success.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it makes that success mean even more.
Yeah.
Whenever you freaking kill it. For me, like anytime that I just end up sucking at something, it was funny because there was an open mic that I was going to, that happened this Sunday. And I was going to try out a whole bunch of new stuff. I had a whole page worth of new material that had never been done at all. And I hadn't done any old stuff in a really, really long time. So I show up and this was normally an open mic that was, it usually has like a smattering of people, just like a little speckling of people listening. Most of them are playing pool. So it just gives you the ability to get up on stage and just
start talking,
speak then. And like actually hear the jokes out loud. It was a packed house. And all of a sudden I was like, and there were no time limits. So they don't give you a light to like tell you to get off the stage when things are going poorly. And I bombed so hard because like, not only that, but I was going to try some edgy stuff.
He went there.
My opening bit was going to be, I can't wait to see African American Panther.
Oh man. Nothing.
Didn't work.
Nothing.
It didn't go well. And then I got off and one of the other comics, it was funny because he was very drunk. But he was like, I kind of lamented to him of like, man, I was just bailing on bits left and right. And I feel like I should have just like walked off and just gone. And he was like, well, here's the thing, dude. Why would you bail on a bit? Like, how are you supposed to? Like, it was the most, it was the weirdest grain of wisdom from the drunkest dude.
Real, yeah. he's giving you this deep knowledge. Yeah.
He made a really great point. It was like, how do you expect to succeed? I'm paraphrasing in less drunken language. How do you expect to succeed if you fail and then you quit and you just walk up the stage and never get behind that microphone again or get behind that computer again and like continue to write? How do you expect to succeed? How do you expect to get better? Like, how do you expect to succeed in anything?
Yeah.
You don't bail on a bit. You don't bail on anything.
I'm gonna type that out and hang it on my computer.
Don't bail on a bit. Yeah. And then just get a picture of a drunken dude holding a 40.
Like, yeah.
Don't bail on a bit.
Equal parts wisdom and insanity.
That is stand-up comedy.
That's it. Well, and I think stand-up comedy is the most terrifying thing somebody could put themselves through.
Yeah,
you
me
know,
too.
I'm rejected most of the time in the privacy of my own home.
I get imagine rejection doing it in front letter. Of a sea of
yeah,
people.
Yeah, no, I can't. We used to watch Last Comic Standing.
Oh, yeah.
I love that show. I'm so sad it went off. And I would just marvel at the bravery of everybody getting up there. And so I commend you because that is not for the faint of heart.
It's terrifying. It's freaking terrifying.
But you do it. And that's amazing.
Yeah. Yep.
Oh, and I unfortunately had witnesses there for that one.
Yeah, I was going to say, I probably wouldn't invite people for a really long time. Like that would be
well,
the
funny thing is that open mic is kind of like my safe place to try new stuff. Like, and that's, I'm a hobbyist stand-up. Like, by no means am I a touring comic or anything like that with, like, road knowledge or anything. Like, I just don't have the chance to even
try that. I don't have the time. So I like to just get up there and do it as a hobby right now. But it's both. It's really fun when you have a good night, and it makes you want to drink heavily when you have a bad night.
Yeah, I don't have the nerves to handle it.
And it sucks because I'm currently on a, I'm trying to reach a year goal of not partaking in the old alcohol. That was rough.
That was a rough night.
I want everyone to know that I was tempted, but I persevered.
There you go.
You need the more socially acceptable vice, like Dr. Pepper.
Yeah.
Although that's fading. Like now, when you go out with like a bunch of friends and they're all like, I'll have water. And you're like, I'll have a Dr. Pepper. They're just looking at you like, the sugar.
Oh my gosh. Dr. Pepper?
And I'm like, the sugar calms me.
Yeah.
I will say my cigarettes fed me well.
That night was an insane Brian night. Sitting in the darkness of his garage.
Well, and it was funny because I actually had one of the folks from Skit Guys came out to see me. And Skit Guys is a faith-based thing where I make it a point to like never smoke around anybody there. And then I got off stage. I was like, thanks for coming. And he'd never seen me before, and it was just like, behold, this is bad.
That's funny.
So, okay.
That was, yeah.
So we're running a little short on time, but do we have some games that we can play?
Yeah, I do. I was inspired by just our conversation, and I thought it's one of my favorite warm-ups to play.
Okay.
And I don't even really know what I think it's just like story structure movie title. Is it either way, I'm going to explain what it is because it doesn't matter what it's called because I don't care. Basically, one person's going to name the title of a movie.
Okay.
The next person is going to say who it's starring.
Ooh.
And then the third person's going to give the plot. If you don't want to participate whatsoever, it's totally fine.
I'm willing. I'm just terrible at this. I am over 40. It's after 8.
No, it's all made up. All made up. So that's okay.
Oh, yeah. It's not real movies?
It's not real movies.
Oh, no,
it's made up,
okay.
Totally made up movies.
Okay.
You can pick real actors and then, or not, it doesn't matter.
Okay.
But so made up title and made up plot.
Oh, good.
So it's real. It's just supposed to go real fast, and we just—it's kind of. It was the log lines that kind of inspired me to do. I love this warm up.
I like it. We haven't done this one on.
No, it's a lot of fun. I enjoy it, and it can go really poorly. So maybe that's just the theme of the night.
We're going to fail. Will if I'm
we're
going to
fail
on the
really well today.
But we're going to
fail really well,
high.
Guys.
Yes. Okay.
Right. So I'll go ahead and just start with the title of the movie and we'll just go in sequential order. And then, Brian, you'll start with the title. That way everyone can kind of take a turn doing all three parts, like naming the actors, naming the giving the plot line.
Okay. Renee, why don't you ring the honorary bell to start this off?
All right. So the title of the movie is Blackness Within the Mind.
Blackness Within the Mind.
Starring
Bruce Willis and Benedict Cumberbatch, the whitest of the two actors you can find.
And it's about a man who has a memory lapse and is in a coma, and we're in his mind the whole time.
Ooh.
But there's nothing there.
Ooh.
It's basically 60 minutes of black screen.
I like it.
That sounds super deep.
It's like Black Mirror. That's like, I don't know what I'm going with that.
Yeah.
Never mind.
No, okay. I like it. Okay. So, Brian.
Yes.
Title of the movie.
Electric Paintings from Beyond.
Electric Paintings from Beyond stars Nicole Kidman coming back from a long trip away.
Hiatus.
Movies.
Yeah.
And Brendan Fraser.
Ooh.
two flashback in time actors that haven't been around. But
whatever happened to Brendan Fraser? Did he die?
No, I think he's in deep debt.
Ooh.
Oh,
that's, yeah.
Or maybe that's
just a made-up BuzzFeed article I read, and I thought, hey, that sounds interesting. What happened to Brendan Fraser?
BuzzFeed?
I don't know.
Brendan Fraser is alive and kicking.
Okay, electric paintings from... What was it?
Electric paintings from beyond.
From beyond. This movie is it's actually a romance, but a super tragic romance. Basically Nicole Kidman's character paints what she envisions her future lover to be. She gets a vision and she sees it, she paints it. But what she doesn't understand is she has to actually paint herself into the painting to be with him. So there's a huge exchange of how they can meet in these alternate realities. And it's not until she kills herself in real life that she can reach her lover.
Disclosure, that actually sounds really interesting.
This is what I'm saying, is we can get some good stuff out of this.
Keep going.
Go on. So...
I like that.
She dies.
You have to write that down. Renee.
All right. Title of the movie.
Okay. He rode in sitting sideways.
He rode in sitting sideways. Ooh. This movie is going to star Bill Murray and Haley Joel Osment, actually.
Haley Joel Osment.
Yeah. My favorite young actor who I had a huge crush on, and now he plays golf and is fat, and I still like him.
He's a cuddly Haley Joel Osment.
He's a cuddly little man.
Okay, He Rode In Sideways, starring Haley Joel Osment and Bill Murray. A Western comedy set in the future.
Oh.
Where gravity has no pool. And the only way to travel on horseback is sideways.
Because some way, the horses
Because the gravity is going this way and this way. It's haywire. And you have to ride your horse in sideways.
And that's science right there.
And Haley Joel Osment plays the bad guy who has his finger on the dial that's about to make gravity exist only one way.
Oh.
Which will make everything go all wrong because it's a Western set in the future.
And we're feeling very sci-fi tonight. Yeah. Like, yeah.
That's
okay. Yeah.
It's all over the place. Literally.
Okay. So let's do one more round.
Okay.
And then... we're going to do a scene from the film that we name.
Oh,
so I don't, if you want to give synopsis or title or it doesn't matter which one we pick now, but yeah, who wants to?
So we're going to do another round
just one more and we're going to do a scene from it.
Ooh, okay. Renee, why don't you do the title?
Yeah, that was a good title.
I seem to be better at that. The log line. Once Upon a Rhyme.
Once Upon a Rhyme.
Once Upon a Rhyme.
Starring Raffi, my favorite 90s children's musical star, Raffi. and Meryl Streep.
Oh, man.
okay. What's this about, Brian?
Once Upon a Rhyme, starring that guy
Raffi.
And Meryl Streep. A coming-of-age tale of how Meryl Streep teaches Raffi how to become the successful rapper that he knows he has inside him.
Raffi the rapper?
That's right.
Okay.
So I really want to be a rapper, but I don't know how to rap. Dang it.
Raffi, I'm going to have to be brutally honest here. I'm not enjoying what you present in this open discussion of rap and what it means. I feel like you as a previous children's singer have, you have some work to do on your character and refinement and you need to get out on the streets. All you know is children. All you know is love and bananas and telephone songs.
Yo, man, forget that, dog. Hit the beat. My beatbox is, he's in the bathroom, so don't imagine that there's a beat. Yo, look at all these kids sitting on the floor. I'm here and I'm rapping and I'm out the dough. What? Mic drop. That's as far as I'm getting. I need to learn how to rap, Meryl.
I'm going to take you to the streets, Raffy. I'm
going to take you to the streets. I need some cred. Give me some street cred, Meryl Streep.
It's Meryl Streep. That's right. That's my street name. It's Meryl Streep.
Oh, dang.
Jump to, cut to Meryl trying to get Raffy to learn how to properly buy drugs.
Oh, jeez.
All right. All right, now. You're using my cred. You're using my name to get in that door. I'm going to need you to procure the goods.
All right,
this is going to teach you dedication, intimidation.
So you want me to go
multiplication, because you're going to need to make sure that it's the right amount.
I need to know math.
Yeah.
Okay. So I need to go through this door, and then I need to pay for the drugs, and then I need to come back out and
still
be alive.
And that is going to make you the rapper that you will become.
That's how I get my street cred, is to still be alive when I come back through the door with the drugs.
Right.
Okay. All right, here we go. I'm gonna knock on the door.
Hello?
Yeah. I'm here for the drugs.
No, we just got a shipment in yesterday. What kind of drugs are you trying to get?
What kind of drugs are you trying to get?
The drugs.
Just drugs. PCP, mofo.
Oh yeah, we got plenty of PCP. We've also got cocaine on discount. We got a little bit of heroin. Let me just pull it out of this guy's arm. Okay, we got heroin.
Raffy. Listen.
Yeah.
I think it's a setup. I think you need to go in there. And I know you want to be a rapper, but right now, they need to be calmed. I can tell. Energy's high up in there. They don't trust you. Go in there and sing their
heroin
songs. Sing what you know.
So
sing your children's songs to them. Calm them so they will give you the drugs.
Okay, all right. I'm going to sing these songs. I'm going to calm them right down. If I just kick this door in. Oh, hi! Oh, he just opened the door. Come on in! Hey, I'm here to get some drugs in a very, inconspicuous way. Which is not being very successful, being inconspicuous right now. I see you got security cameras. I see microphones all over the place. This is terrifying. I'm pretty sure I'm going to jail after this, but let me sing y'all a song. Drugs is so bad. Drugs is so bad. Here we go. Let's talk about the drugs being really, really bad. Yeah. Oh, drugs. Oh, I wish I could get some drugs from you. And then I could go and I could sell it to Meryl outside. Meryl Streep. Oh, shoot. Oh, I just named her.
Did you say Meryl?
I mean,
oh, we got her drugs right here.
Marv Streeterton.
That was a great song, by the way. I feel very calm and I trust you and your soul. You have a nice soul.
Thank you for your compliments on my soul.
Here are the drugs.
Oh, thanks. Here's the drugs. Okay, I'm out of here. Okay, bye, Kunk.
Don't you see, Raffy? Don't you see it now? Don't you feel it inside of you?
I feel it inside me.
You're a rapper now.
I think I might be. Okay.
Guys, that's what failure sounds like.
That's exactly what failure sounds like.
That's what failure sounds like.
Woo!
On a very surfacey level.
We should not stop doing like scenes without warming up or anything.
I
haven't seen Kelly in like a month.
I'm not on my game. I'm going to blame it on pregnancy brain, which, people say is a myth, and I think it's real.
It's real.
It's real.
It's real.
I want it to be just so that I can accuse somebody of pregnancy brain.
Pregnancy brain.
Johnson, where are those reports? Do you have pregnancy brain again?
Yeah, you know what? I wish I could use that.
I've been working out, sir. Go back into your closet. Well,
so,
Renee,
yeah.
Thank you so much for coming out and enduring that awesomeness. We're killing it. So where exactly can we find you online?
You can find me on my fabulous website.
It's pretty great.
ReneeGutteridge.com.
And it's not bland.
Nope. Soon it will have a list of failures that you can also view.
Yeah. If I thought people actually came to my website, I'd take the time to do that, but I'm not sure. So I feels like I could use my time better. But.
And then are you on social media at all?
Yep. I'm on Facebook and Twitter, but mostly on Facebook.
Okay.
I have an author page, Renee Gutteridge.
Nice. And I think you can also find Renee on Wikipedia.
Boom.
Can you?
Oh, yeah.
Am I back? Oh, I've got to tell this great story. Oh. I was on Wikipedia for a while, and then I went to show, like, my child or something, and it came up not relevant.
Oh!
And I'd been removed from Wikipedia.
Oh, man.
And I was like, oh, that hurts that so much. And I never went back. I assumed I'm still not relevant.
There you go. Oh, now gosh. You can go back and really brag to your kids this time. You're like, see?
Yeah.
See? See, I'm there now. I'm not relevant.
That needs to be a bit that goes into the Skip Guys thing.
Told you, Mom.
I can totally see that scene between Ed and Tom.
Yeah.
Wikipedia me. I'm here. Not relevant.
Go see if Tom and Ed are on Wikipedia. Like, who? I don't know. Like, that's exciting. If I'm on Wikipedia, they have lowered their standards of what is relevant. But that's fun. I don't even know who... put me on the first time. It kind of is creepy. Like, who
someone
put
was
me
like, hey,
on?
I know this person. I'm going to make
it.
But isn't that kind of like the unofficial sign of like killing it?
Yeah.
You got a Wikipedia page.
Until your Amazon reviewer was like, I'm going to take this page down. She's not. I'm mad at her for her bug.
I'm putting a direct link in my email signature right to my Wikipedia page. Like, forget my website.
Look at me.
Just go to Wikipedia. Yeah.
I am relevant. All right, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Sure.
You are awesome, and you're a blast to work with. And for those of you who don't know yet, it'd be weird if you didn't, I guess, if you're listening to this podcast, but you can follow us on Instagram and Facebook and Twitter at Okie Show Show, and you can also go to our website, www.com.okieshowshow.com, and then you can also look at some of the sketches that we've written at our YouTube channel that does not have a freaking domain name because YouTube is retarded and stole our domain name.
Brian's mad at YouTube.
I am.
You know what? If you go to our Patreon and donate some money, you can hear Brian's whole hour-long rant about YouTube and how stupid it is.
Which is typically how those secret episodes turn out to be.
But they're fun.
Like the main perk of doing Patreon.
I was thinking I want to add some new perks for anyone who's interested. My son can now draw things. It's not just scribbles. So maybe if you just go donate a dollar or something, I'll have Oliver draw you up. It's probably going to be a Pokemon. And I'm probably going to actually be the one drawing it.
Perfect.
And he'll color it a little bit.
So,
but it'll be with love.
Beautiful. So that's it. So we'll see you guys in the next 2 weeks. All right.
Okay, bye.
It's the Okie Show.